So we have close to 88 people joining. Shall we start or wait for another few minutes?
Maybe 2 more minutes we can wait. 7:35 sharp we'll start for that. People are still joining, I think.
Volume wise, you're fine, no? Someone has written volume is low. You're able to hear clearly, no?
Volume is your own connectivity and adjustments. Because Zoom volume is full this thing only.
Yeah, you're able to hear us.
Yes.
We can hear you clearly. And you can...
For me, no problem. Others, I don't know.
Yeah. Naishra, you're able to hear us clearly? Okay. Now, okay.
Yeah, I can hear very clearly.
Yeah. 35.
Shall we start, sir? Yeah. So, Dr. Arvind?
Chair,
right. Shall we start? Dr. Naishra, shall we start?
Ready for you.
Yeah, we can start. Thank you.
Okay. Good evening, everyone, and welcome to this another session of NOEL, the NNF online learning platform, which is being well received by all of you. Last week, we discussed about choosing the right anotropes, and we're overwhelmed with the participation of all the delegates, the fellows. And this week, we have another very important topic as a neonatologist. approach to a child who's suspected to have critical congenital heart disease. So let me take this opportunity to thank Dr. Manoj. I take this opportunity. Manoj has been instrumental in the NOEL, the committee. He has been an important member, the co-chairperson, and he has been a valuable support in providing the Zoom platform and also giving a lot of ideas. So thank you. He's also agreed to sort of moderate today's session, and it is from his unit, Jubilee Mission Medical College, that today his student is going to present this case-based discussion on approach to critical congenital heart disease. Not all child who deteriorates is sepsis, or not all child who deteriorates will have some respiratory issues. So a lot of times we do not know how to approach to a child with congenital heart disease, which is the one which is critical. When do we sort of, not all of you have access to sort of echo immediately. Is the role of ECG redundant now? Why people are not using ECG? How X-ray should help us into come to critical bedside diagnosis? And what should we do with post-stack learning? What dose should we start? How should we go up? A lot of questions practically people would be thinking about in different clinical settings you are. To address all these questions, we have two prominent personalities today. We're lucky to have two experts. I take this opportunity to introduce our two experts. Thank you, Dr. Nageshwar Rao. Dr. Nageshwar Rao is a prominent pediatric cardiologist. He is the chief pediatric cardiologist at Rainbow Children's Heart Institute at Hyderabad. He has over 30 years of experience in pediatric cardiology. There's a few big papers with his CV is going through, so I won't go through the whole thing, but I can say that he is known for his innovation. He designed a wall called Coniti Wall, which is being used not only in India, but also abroad, which is, which is remarkable, from his innovation and other things. He's got numerous prizes and he's a great teacher and he's very well known in his, not only in the pediatric cardiology circle, but a lot of neonatologists and pediatrics know him very well. So I think especially with the pediatric cardiology topics, I think we're lucky to have someone like him who would give us answer to a lot of questions which we'll have. And we're also lucky to have Dr. Arvind Shenoy. Dr. Arvind Shenoy, as you know, is one of the senior most neonatologists. He's one of the first DM neonatologists in the country, well-respected teachers across. And we thank you, Arvind, for sort of accepting our invitation. He's the director and the head of the neonatology department at Cloud9 Hospital in Bangalore, the airport road. And all of us known for his great sort of oration, the way he teaches, the way he takes classes. So very thank you, Arvind, for this. And I'm sure all the students will benefit from your expert advice and your teaching. So two great teachers today. So over to you, Manoj, and please take the session forward.
Thank you. Respected seniors, my dear friends, so welcome to another module of NOEL. Anyway, the second one in the cardiac. Last time we thoroughly enjoyed the inotropes and the discussion on shock and things like that. Today we are going to go on to another practical problem, which, as was rightly introduced by Dr. Dinesh Charla, is one of the common dilemmas that we all face when we handle babies. How are we going to approach a baby? How are you going to diagnose a critical congenital heart disease? How are you going to stabilize and then probably transport it to the cardiac unit? So without wasting much time, if there are no remarks from the experts, we have Dr. Nageshwar Rao and Dr. Arun Shanai. Anything for you to say, sirs? Otherwise, we'll start with the case. You want to say anything before we start?
I think we'll straight away start the case.
Arvind Shanai, sir?
Please start.
Okay. So today, one of my colleagues in Jubilee, he is my fellow, Dr. Nijo Francis, will be presenting the case and discussion. And after that, we will open it up. So please feel free to ask your questions in the Q&A box. There's a Q&A box. because you may not be able to talk until there is a specific requirement. There is no need also. So please ask all your questions, not in the chat box, in the Q&A box, so that it can be, I will try to answer as many as possible. Last time the session was stretching too long, but then let's see how much we can discuss. The idea of this whole exercise is that, and at the end of the session, you should be able to clear all your doubts. And after you finish your fellowship, all of you are going to manage cases with help or without help. And at that time, there should be no doubt that you have clear-cut ideas on how to manage. So the practical aspects will be important. At the same time, the exam orientation is also equally important. I'll not waste any more time. Nijo? Dr. Nijo, please take over.
My screen visible?
Yeah, you can make it in the slideshow mode. Yes, I hope it's visible to everybody.
Good evening, everybody. Today we'll be discussing regarding diagnosis and management of a critical congenital heart disease in a baby. My name is Dr. Nijo Francis. I'll be taking you for the next 1 hour or so regarding diagnosis and critical management of critical congenital heart disease. Now let's talk about a case. A 3.2 kg infant is born via cesarean section due to non-progression of labor at 39 weeks of gestation to a primary gravida woman with an unremarkable medical and obstetric history. Baby was vigorous at birth with breathing comfortably and appears to be pink. At 5 minutes of life, the preductal saturation value in room air is 90%. And postductal value being 82%. Now, what is the cause for this? Let's have a poll. What is the baby having? Let's see. Baby is continued observation, consultation with pediatric cardiology, stat echocardiogram, four extremity blood pressure, arterial blood gas determination from the left arm, pedilateral. Well, yes, we have the answers. Most of them have got it correct. It's continued observation. Now, let's see what is the idea behind it. Now, transfusion circulation, we have three shunts basically. We have ductus venous shunt that bypasses the liver. We have foramen ovale opening in the interatrial septa to bypass pulmonary circulation. We have the ductus arteriosus, which transfers the blood from the right ventricle to the aorta. And we have both the fetal ventricles, right and left, responsible for the blood flow to the placenta systemic circuit. The fetal heart is forgiving to the baby, as in the most complex congenital heart disease also, with atmosphere shunts. The right ventricle and the left ventricle ensures that the fetal blood, oxygenated blood, reaches the most of the vital organs. And also, we should be taking care of the account regarding resistance in the fetal pulmonary vasculature. Regarding the fetal pulmonary vasculature, it immediately after birth, the female fetal pulmonary vasculature blood flow increases, and resistance decreases. And also, parallel fetal circulatory system promotes an efficient oxygen delivery in a relatively hypoxic environment. Now, high oxygen tension promotes postnatal closure of the ductus arteriosus, and functional closure takes place in the first hours to days after birth. Median preductal oxygen saturation, a term infant being 90% at 5 minutes, and increases to 98% by 50 minutes of life. Now, postductal saturation is lower than the preductal in the first 50 minutes of life. The gradient between the preductal and the postductal saturation decreasing over time. And also, the postnatal closure of the ductus may be life-threatening in case if the defect is a duct-dependent lesion. Now, let's discuss another case. We have an outbound baby, early term, 37 weeks of gestation, 2.55 kg, male infant, referred to a hospital at 4 hours of life with history of bluish discoloration of lips, arms, and legs and low saturation with tachypnea. Mother being a 21-year-old primary, with O positive blood group, with uneventful, unremarkable antenatal period, and all antenatal scans was normal. Baby was vigorous at birth, had tachypnea with bluish discoloration of lips, tongue, arms, and legs. Let's have a poll. True or false? Peripheral cyanosis signals underlying arterial hypoxemia. True or false? Clinical recognition of central cyanosis, is it easier in a neonate with polycythemia than those with a normal hemoglobin concentration? Does this infant in this clinical scenario, is it related to the cyanosis related to lung disease? Report. Okay. Yeah, let's see the answers. Peripheral cyanosis signals underlying arterial hypoxemia. It's not true. It's true. Clinical recognition of central cyanosis is easier in neonates with polycythemia than those with is false, because polycythemia we need reduced the amount of reduced hemoglobin concentration should be higher in a polycythemic baby. And also this infant in cyanosis, is it most related to lung disease? It is false. It's related to cardiac. We'll be discussing it later. Now let's see what is cyanosis. It's simply put, bluish or purple discoloration of the skin or mucous membrane caused by increased concentration of deoxygenated hemoglobin. Well, we'll be discussing mainly on central cyanosis, which is significant, which is deoxygenated hemoglobin concentration exceeding 3 to 5 gram per deciliter more. It's more evident in lips, tongue, hands, feet, and mucous membrane. Or the membranes of the oral cavity. Now, central cyanosis, it may be due to pulmonary or cardiac cause. In pulmonary, we have increased work of breathing and intensity of cyanosis is less in a pulmonary cause compared to cardiac cause. And also, the response to a hyperoxia test is more in a pulmonary cause. In cardiac, the work of breathing is minimal. And also, in cyanosis is more evident, central cyanosis in particular. And also, the response to hyperoxia test is less. And also, we can take the help clinically based on a pathological murmur, perfusion of the baby, help from chest x-ray, gestation as in preterm, more prone for respiratory distress, and also history of the baby. Now, we have an central cyanosis. Simply put, there is an underlying cause for neonatal hypoxemia, maybe due to a pulmonary cause or a cardiac cause. Now, how do you go about pulmonary? It may be due to a ventilation perfusion mismatch, or maybe a diffusion abnormality, or maybe secondary to hyperventilation. You have lung disease as a respiratory distress syndrome. You have a meconium aspiration syndrome, pneumonia, or maybe secondary to pulmonary edema. Pleural disease as in pleural effusion, pneumothorax, chylothorax. Airway disease as an upper airway obstruction, cholelectasia, micropneumonia, vascular ring, or a CNS or a muscle disease as in hypoxemic encephalopathy, central apnea. Now, cardiac cause, they may have due to decreased pulmonary blood flow or with the normal pulmonary blood flow. The decreased pulmonary blood flow, we have heterogeneous phenomenon with severe pulmonary stenosis or atresia, or tricuspid valve stenosis or atresia, or resistance anomaly, or we have a pulmonary atresia with intact ventricular sector. Now, with normal blood flow, within a cardiac case, with hypoxemia, maybe secondary to a DTGA or a truncus arteriosus. Now, coming back to a case, a baby was referred to an NICU from outside hospital at 4 hours of life on oxygen food in view of central cyanosis, low saturation, and also minimal respiratory distress. On arrival in an NICU, baby temperature being 36.8 euglycemic, with respiratory rate 70 per minute, the Downing score of 3, with heart rate in the range of 140 per minute, with saturation, the right term recorded 70% in room air. Now, BP recorded the right term, mean BP 60, with right term and capillary refilling time of less than 3 seconds and peripheries were warm to touch. In view of progressively increasing respiratory distress, we connected the baby to CPAP. Baby was connected to CPAP on arrival in NICU. In view of progressively increasing respiratory distress and low saturation. Now, baby was connected to CPAP initial settings of PEEP 6 and FiO 21%, with FiO requirement going up to 50% in the initial few minutes. The saturation recorded are as follows, the right arm and left limbs. Right arm being 85% and left arm and legs being 75, 74 and 75% respectively. Blood pressure recorded in the right arm and the left arm. In right arm, the mean BP being 60, left arm being 66, leg being 69 and 64 respectively. On examination, we have an active alert baby on CPAP with no anomalies or dysmorphism, with no other congenital anomalies. There is distress, tachypnea with respiratory rate 70 per minute with nasal flaring, but there is no grunt or chest retractions or enjoying the Downey score 3. We have normal male genitalia with bilateral distributed testes, coronal patency and inlaw orifice were checked. All pulses were felt and also bilateral femurs were also felt. On auscultation, a baby had systolic murmur grade 3 intensity with best heard over the left sternal border in the second and third intercostal space. Capillary blood gas was obtained at 4 hours of life with pH 7.304 with PCO2 46, bicarbonate 20, lactate 4, electrolytes were in the normal limits, and hematocrit was 62. Baby was started on tube feeds at 60 ml per kg per day and on CPAP continued with PEEP 6 and FiO2 50%. Chest X-ray was obtained immediately, which shows cardiomegaly with oligemic lung fields. Echo was obtained at 6 hours of life after admission in hospital. It showed DTGA with Austin secondary AST with predominant left right shunt with 3.5 mm PDA left right shunt with normal biventricular function, suggestive of a duct dependent lesion. Now, what are critical congenital heart disease? The American Heart Association has defined critical congenital heart disease as any congenital heart disease which requires intervention within the first year of life. A more practical definition would be critical congenital heart disease, which required intervention or which may have resulted in death within 28 days of life or if no intervention have been done. The incidence of congenital heart disease is approximately 10 per every 1,000 live births. And the incidence of critical congenital heart disease, which needs intervention in the early infancy period, being 3 in 1,000 live births. This is data from India. Now, critical congenital heart disease are broadly divided into duct-dependent pulmonary circulation and duct-dependent systemic circulation. Duct-dependent pulmonary circulation with right heart lesions as in pulmonary atresia with intact ventricular septum, pulmonary atresia with ventricular septal defect. We have pulmonary atresia with single ventricle, critical pulmonary stenosis, severe Epstein anomaly, tetralogy of Fallot with critical right ventricular outflow, outlet tract obstruction, TGA with intact septum. Now, duct-dependent systemic circulation, we have interrupted aortic arch, hypoplastic left heart syndrome, critical aortic stenosis, critical coarctation of aorta, and complex lesion variant as in TAPVC and TGA with VSD and TAPVC with obstruction. Now, regarding the time of presentation, a critical congenital heart disease that present with cyanosis as in DTGA, TAPVC, tricuspid atresia, Epstein's anomaly, truncus arteriosus, pulmonary atresia, or hypoplastic left heart syndrome, they usually present immediately after birth or up to 2 weeks. They present early. Now, tetralogy of Fallot, they may present from birth or they may present within 12 weeks depending on the severity of the pulmonary stenosis. How severe the pulmonary stenosis depends on it. Now, congenital heart diseases that present with shock as in coarctation of aorta, critical coarctation of aorta or aortic stenosis, they usually present anytime from immediately birth. Now, how do we arrive at diagnosing a critical congenital heart disease? After clinical examination or with clues from presentation of the baby. And also we take help from bedside diagnostic tools as with the help of pulse oximetry, chest X-ray, ECG. And lastly, we take help from functional echocardiography and later on to diagnose with a detailed echocardiography. Antenatally, we take a good detailed history regarding previous children with cardiac illness, therapy and exposure to the mother, substance abuse in the mother, maternal infection during antenatal period, family history, positivity, newborns with congenital heart disease, roughly have they have 10 to 15% of family members with history of congenital heart disease, and also antenatal scans and fetal echocardiography. Now, for which all mothers require fetal echo? There are maternal indications and fetal indications for doing a fetal echo. Maternal indications as in first degree related with the congenital heart disease, prior child with congenital heart disease, metabolic conditions in the mother, maternal infection as intrauterine infection, autoimmune disorders and teratogen exposures. Fetal indication, increased nuchal translucency related to the antenatal scan or abnormal ductus venosus waveform, an abnormal fetal screen on antenatal scan or major extra cardiac anomaly, an abnormal fetal karyotype if it has been done, or hydrops or effusion in the baby, or persistent bradycardia or tachycardia. The ideal time to do a fetal echocardiography is 18 to 22 weeks. Now, clinically, how do these babies present in our NICU? They may present with cyanosis, as we discussed earlier, mostly predominantly central cyanosis to be specific. They may also present with systemic hyperperfusion or shock. They may also show signs and symptoms of failure. They may also have a murmur, or they may also show increased work of breathing. Now, we have already discussed central cyanosis and how to differentiate between pulmonary and pulmonary cause from a cardiac cause for central cyanosis. Now, coming to systemic hyperperfusion, they may present with cardiogenic shock in units. Differentiating a cardiogenic shock from other causes clinically is challenging. Now, they may have the clues that we get a cardiomegaly in an X-ray and also low postductal saturation to differentiate from other causes of shock. Now, serially increasing blood lactate levels, which signifies tissue oxygen depth, indicates a low cardiac output and also indicates the severity of the disease. Now, congenital heart diseases which present with systemic hyperperfusion are mostly lesions with left heart obstructive lesions, as in aortic stenosis, coarctation of aorta, or interrupted aortic arch, hyperplastic left heart syndrome. Also, secondly, to cardiac muscle disorders, arrhythmias, or cardiac metabolic disorders. Now, neonates may also present with cardiac failure, with tachypnea, increased work of breathing, tachycardia, cardiomegaly on X-ray, hepatomegaly or splenomegaly. They may have pulmonary edema, generalized edema. They may also have decreased urine output, head sweating, irritability, or feeding difficulty, as in feeding, specifically suppressed subcycle. Now, increased work of breathing, they may have tachypnea, chest wall retractions. The main differential being pulmonary causes. Differentiating pulmonary cause from a cardiac cause, we have discussed earlier, is challenging. Lack of improvement or worsening with conventional respiratory management is an early indicator for doing a functional echocardiography and a detailed echocardiography later. Now, once you detect a murmur in the neonate, when we are suspecting a heart lesion, the neonate has signs of heart failure or lower limb saturation, lower compared to postductal being, there's a marked difference between preductal and postductal difference, and also femorals are absent or weak. Yes. The neonate need to be urgently evaluated. We are suspecting a significant congenital heart disease. We need a functional echo and a detailed echo thereafter. Now, if we are suspecting a heart lesion, we get loud murmur more than 2 grain intensity, we have a diastolic murmur, or we have an abnormal ECG, and associated dysmorphism history, well, the baby requires evaluation and echo before discharge. Anyway, the baby needed to be evaluated before discharge. Now, the bedside tool that we take help from, let's see some of the bedside tools that we take help in diagnosing critical congenital heart disease. Firstly and mostly, we take help from pulse oximetry. It's ideally, in an asymptomatic baby, it's ideally done between 24 to 48 hours of birth or before discharge, if the baby is getting discharged before 24 hours. One sensor is placed on the right hand and the other on the feet. We measure preductal and postductal saturation differences. Now, the saturation screen, pulse oximetry screen, it's measured, as we mentioned earlier, with one sensor on the right hand and the other on the left foot. If saturation record is less than 90% in the hand or foot, it's an abnormal screen. It's said to be positive. If we get 90 to 94% in hand or foot, or there's more than 2 to 3% of preductal and postductal difference, and if the baby is asymptomatic, we repeat the screen after 20 to 60 minutes. And the saturation is still less than 90% in the hand or foot, still an abnormal screen requires evaluation. if the baby is asymptomatic and you repeat and you get 90 to 94% borderline, or you get more than 2% or 3% difference between pre-ductal and post-ductal difference, well, still an abnormal screen. If the saturation is recorded more than 95% in hand and foot and less than 2% in pre-ductal and the post-ductal difference, it's insignificant and it's a normal screen. The baby is fit for discharge. And also, if the saturation is more than 95% in the hand and foot and less than 2%, the pre-ductal and post-ductal difference is also a normal screen. All babies with abnormal screen should undergo a detailed echocardiography to confirm whether there is an underlying cardiac pathology. Now, pulse oximetry newborn screening, it is to detect clinically silent hypoxemia in babies with critical congenital heart disease. The main advantage being increased early detection. It's very easy to do, non-invasive and cost-effective. And also, the false positive test that we get are babies that has an underlying problem, an underlying cause for that neonatal hypoxemia, which requires evaluation. Disadvantage being decreased sensitivity and also increasing the false positive rates if done before 12 hours. Now, this pulse oximetry screen has a sensitivity of 76.5% and a specificity for 99.9% with a false positive rate of 0.14%. It is highly specific with moderate sensitivity. So, this may be regarded as an ideal screening tool for detection of critical congenital heart disease. Now, hyperoxia test is another test we use in NICU. It's a bedside screening tool to differentiate between a cardiac cause or from cardiac cause from the other causes. We administer 100% oxygen either through a mask, or if the baby is on invasive respiratory support, we give a tracked FiO2 of 100% for 5 to 10 minutes. If the arterial oxygen measured preductally is more than 300 mercury, it is normal. It is less likely cardiac if it is somewhere around 150 to 300, maybe secondary to a pulmonary disorder or a CNS disorder. It is likely cardiac if the value is somewhere around 100 to 150, maybe secondary to persistent pulmonary hypertension of newborn, or we have a secondary cardiac mixing lesion with increased pulmonary blood flow. Very likely cardiac if it is less than 100, the arterial oxygen level doesn't go up. In spite of giving 100% oxygen for 5 to 10 minutes, we may have a cardiac condition with parallel circulation or a cardiac mixing lesion with a restricted pulmonary blood flow. Now, finally, and most importantly, the tool that we use in diagnosing and confirming a critical congenital heart disease is a functional echocardiography. With the principle of point of care, targeted and focused approach, it is rightly regarded as telescope of the future. It is used to evaluate cardiac anatomy and also to estimate the intracardiac pressure and also to measure the pressure gradient across the valve and vessel. Also to determine the direction of the blood flow and also to measure the pressure gradient across a defect, and also to estimate the filling pressure and the fluid responsiveness. Now, 2D echo gives us a high resolution image of cardiac structure, movement, and vascular structure leaving the heart. It's by directing the plane of the transducer beam across each cross-sectional planes of the heart and the vessels. Routine 2D echo has four transducer locations, as in parasternal, apical, suprasternal, and subcostal approach. And we have the short axis view and the long axis view and the four chamber view. Qualitative value derived from two-dimensional echocardiography gives us an idea regarding the dimensions of the cardiovascular structures in the left ventricular mass. M-mode echo gives a graphical display of one-dimensional slice of the cardiac structure over time regarding the ventricular wall thickness, cavity dimension, and also calculation of the ventricular shortening fractions. Doppler echocardiography helps us study the cardiac structure and also the blood flow profile. We have a positive Doppler shift and a negative Doppler shift. Positive Doppler shift when the transmitted beam comes towards the transducer beam, and negative Doppler shift when it goes away from the transducer beam. We have a Doppler echo technique. We use continuous wave and pulse wave technique. Continuous wave, we use extremely high velocity technique in which used to identify severe stenosis, and pulse wave targeted lesion as in presence and direction of cardiac shunt, and also detecting stenosis and regurgitation, also stenosis of the blood vessels. Summarizing, how does a duct dependent pulmonary circulation present and just recollecting, ectopium pulmonary circulation as in pulmonary atresia with intact pulmonary septum, pulmonary atresia with ventricular septal defect, pulmonary atresia with a single ventricle, critical pulmonary stenosis, severe Epstein anomaly, tetralogy of Fallot with a critical right ventricular outlet tract obstruction, and TGA with an intact septum. Now, blood flow to the pulmonary artery from the heart is impaired due to severe pulmonary stenosis or pulmonary atresia. Now, the ductus is the only source for pulmonary blood flow. The saturation drops when the arterial duct closes because there is inadequate pulmonary blood flow and oxygenation. Lungs are grossly underperfused. We have predominant cyanosis and increased work of breathing. Chest X-ray classically shows pulmonary oligemia. So basically, we have a cyanotic baby with oligemia on chest X-ray. Some individual conditions. We have pulmonary atresia with intact septum, which presents as cyanotic congenital heart disease. The right atrium is dilated with hypoplastic right ventricle. We have associated tricuspid regurgitation. Chest X-ray shows pulmonary oligemia due to the severity of the atretic pulmonary band. In case if we have a pulmonary plethora in a pulmonary atresia with intact septum baby, it is mainly due to a large left side shunt from the PDA. In complete DTGA with intact ventricular septum, we have ventriculo-arterial discordance. The aorta comes from the right ventricle and the pulmonary artery comes from the left ventricle. So we have a parallel circulation. Classically we get egg on string appearance in the chest X-ray due to narrowing of the mediastinum. Echo, we can demonstrate pulmonary artery arising from the left ventricle and aorta from the right ventricle, which shows discordant nature. Best appreciated in the parasternal long axis view and also confirmed blood flow direction may be confirmed with the Doppler imaging. Now, duct-dependent systemic circulation, the lesions that come under duct-dependent systemic circulation, as we mentioned earlier, are interrupted aortic arch, hypoplastic left heart syndrome, critical aortic stenosis, and critical coarctation of aorta. The basic physiology being left heart outflow obstruction with aortic outflow from the left heart, left ventricle being decreased. The ductus shunts the blood from the artery, pulmonary artery to the aorta to maintain the systemic circulation. We have left heart obstructive lesions, as I mentioned earlier. The main presentation being with systemic hypoperfusion and shock. The lower limb BP will be on the lower side, roughly about 10 to 15 mm mercury less than the upper limb BP. And the femoral pulsations will be weak or feeble, or you may not be able to palpate. Here you can see hypoplastic left heart syndrome with the left ventricle being atretic and inadequate to pump the blood to the systemic circulation, depend on the ductus for oxygenation. Critical coarctation of aorta. Here you can see the coarctation picked up in the suprasternal view and echocardiography. The pulses are, femoral pulses are weak, and also the lower limb BP is less than 10 to 15 compared to the upper limb BP. Now coming to total enamel pulmonary venous connection. It's a mixture lesion with supracardiac, cardiac, infracardiac mixed pattern. The most common TAPVC being supracardiac. You can see here, you can see the vertical vein joining the right atrium. The pulmonary veins doesn't join the left atrium. So there is inadequate blood coming from the lungs to the left atrium. So they may, infracardiac TAPVC may present with an obstructive pattern. Usually in echo, we should be able to demonstrate the joining of the pulmonary veins into the heart. X-ray shows a classical snowman appearance or a figure of eight or a cottage leaf appearance in later stages. What we usually get in the initial days is the ground glass appearance that we get in an obstructive lesion as in infracardiac TAPVC. An echo gives features of right ventricular overload with inability to image the pulmonary veins entering the left atrium. Now, once we make a diagnosis of a critical congenital heart disease, our first priority should be stabilization of the baby in order to shift the baby to a center with cardiac expertise. Now, basics are ensuring thermoneutral environment to the baby, ensure the temperature is maintained, and also closely monitor the vitals, heart rate, respiratory rate, blood pressure. appropriate respiratory support in case if the baby requires an invasive respiratory support, provide it, and hydrate the baby, adequate IV fluids and feeds, and also regarding initiation of prostaglandin to keep the ducts open. Now coming to a baby with DTGA and PDA, baby was started on prostaglandin infusion at 0.075 mice per kg per minute, followed by a maintenance infusion at 0.01 mice per kg per minute. Baby was intubated and referred at 8 hours of life to a pediatric cardiac center. Arterial switch operation was done at 1 week of life. Presently, the baby is doing well at 2 months of life and on regular follow-up. Now, regarding prostaglandin infusion, once the diagnosis of a duct-dependent lesion has been made, in order to keep the ducts open, we need to start prostaglandin.
Can we discuss continuously, or can we actually allow the students to have some questions and then go to the slides?
Sir, actually the discussion will be prolonged. So we will, what we usually do is we finish the presentation and then, okay, then take up the exercise.
Absolutely fine.
Yes.
Regarding prostaglandin infusion.
Did you try to wind up?
Sir, yes, sir. Now, regarding prostaglandin infusion, we have it is given to prevent progressing hypoxia and metabolic acidosis in the case duct closes. It is also used for temporary management of the neonate with duct-dependent congenital heart disease. It's available as 500 microgram in 1 ml. The dose being 0.05 to 0.07 microgram per kg per minute, and the maintenance dose being 0.01 to 0.02 microgram per kg per minute. Once diluted, the solution is stable for 24 hours. Dose is greater than 0.1 microgram per kg per minute, it's not effective, and also the adverse reactions are more. The response is usually obtained within 10 to 15 minutes. Once the response is not obtained with the said dose, the dose may be titrated up, not beyond 1 microgram per kg per minute, as adverse reactions are more common and more evident with 1 microgram per kg per minute. The half-life being one full circulation time, roughly about 14 to 15 seconds in the neonate, hence the need for a continuous infusion. And also the adverse reactions are apnea, fever, flushing, vasodilation, tachycardia, NAC, and gastric outlet obstruction in case if you have to give PGN infusion beyond 1 week. And also twitching are noted. Recurrent apnea after starting prostaglandin infusion is indication for immediate mechanical ventilation intubation. Now, once we start prostaglandin infusion and initial stabilization has been done, now, principles of transport. We need to transport the baby from the hospital to a pediatric cardiac center for intervention. The principles of transport being pre-transport stabilization, TOPS, temperature, oxygenation, airway, breathing, perfusion, sugars, all should be monitored and looked into. Now, regarding elective intubation, should be intubated or not? Now, congenital heart disease on prostaglandin infusion of more than 0.05 microgram per kg per minute in view of risk of apnea may be intubated. There is no nothing like we should intubate or not. Now, regarding care during transport, prior information regarding the baby condition details should be communicated to the hospital of referral. Transport equipment, in case of the, especially in a cardiac case, we need to have the resuscitative equipment, and also the basic unit transport environment should be ensured, ideally in an incubator, transport incubator. And also the members of the transport team should be briefed regarding what the baby condition is and also regarding resuscitation. Now, summarizing take-home message, critical congenital heart disease, the need for diagnosing early should be stressed upon. None of the critical congenital heart diseases are incompatible with life. Early intervention need being need of the hour. And also stress on the importance of antenatal workup and also pulse oximetry screening. And also good clinical examination role of echo in arriving at the diagnosis. And also regarding transport from the hospital of diagnosis to the center of intervention. Thank you.
Thank you, Nijo. Please stop sharing the slide. May I now request comments from our experts, Dr. Nagesh Rao and Dr. Arvind Shanai, before we open up.
It's a good presentation. Thank you very much. I think your illustrative cases, the last case is really very good. You actually explained everything, ductal-dependent, systemic, pulmonary, and also initial stabilization of that. Maybe we have a lot of scope to discuss how to recognize the clinical with which are very subtle findings may be available sometimes. So that point probably we can discuss right now.
There are some questions regarding that already in the Q&A box. So do we take up the right now or?
Yeah, I think straight away we can answer or we can, whoever is the moderator, they can actually moderate.
First question was on practical points in CVS exams, a very general question. CVS exam in UNAID with CHD, importance of apical impulse, BEAT, S2 and person, so S3 and S4. It's talking about cardiac generally.
In a neonate especially, first go one by one. Pulse is the most important thing that already discussed, that if there are no femorals, it's a very, very dangerous situation. Sometimes you may not identify the femorals. You put the plethysmography, upper limb and lower limb plethysmography, right upper limb, not left upper limb. Right upper limb, lower limb, your plethysmography should be upslope and descent. If you have blunted signal in the lower limb, that is very critical. Second point is JVP, you cannot understand in neonate. It is not possible. Third, precardial palpation. If there is active precardium, the right ventricular pulsations in the subxiphoid, cardiomegaly, active precardium is there, your hand is rocking, then it is very, very important, because all babies will have right ventricular apex. Left ventricular apex is seen only in certain conditions like left ventricular outflow tract obstructions like aortic stenosis. Even in aortic stenosis, neonatal PVR will not fall down. So that's why right ventricular dominance is universal in most of the neonates with the critical congenital heart disease, except in hypoplastic right heart syndrome. So presence of left ventricular apex usually suggests either tricuspid atresia or pulmonary atresia intact septum, that is called as hypoplastic left heart syndrome. Third is single ventricle. By and large, remaining all heart diseases will have right ventricular apex. Then third point is auscultation. All babies will have loud P2. Most of the congenital heart disease, except in case of pulmonary atresia groups, where single component is aortic component. It's very difficult to auscultate because you have a tachycardia of 160, 150. That's why heart sound emphasis is not really done in case of neonates, except you have a gallop rhythm, which is tuck, 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 tuck. If it is there, then you have S3 or S4 gallop. But S4 identification, S3 identification, practically it is impossible, and don't waste time on that and discuss also in neonate. Murmurs are very important. Any diastolic murmur is dangerous and it is suggestive of serious heart disease. Systolic murmur, we will talk. I think there are questions. Maybe Sar can, Dr. Manoj can now go on.
Thank you, sir. Excellent explanation. May I request Arvind Shanai, sir, for your comments before we go on to the next question?
I think it's an excellent presentation. My only emphasis is what you already said. It is important to differentiate respiratory from cardiac purpose. Most often, like in this baby, you put the baby on CPAP, thinking it is respiratory. So most of us pediatricians think of respiratory causes, and I think that has to be emphasized, that you always think respiratory first, not cardiac first, unless the points which Nageshwar Rao Garu has so nicely said, unless those points are evident, you first think of respiratory. Back to you.
Excellent, sir. Actually, we all have heard this dictum, common things first. And if you make a rare diagnosis, you are rarely correct. And rare symptoms of a common disease is more common than the common disease of a rare disease. So always that's a very well said point, sir. Respiratory, respiratory, respiratory only, then the cardiac comes. But there may be scenarios where the distress may not be the predominant component. There is no distress, and then you have the hypoxemia cyanosis. Then probably you can think of cardiac. But otherwise, it's probably exactly the way. Thank you, sir. Excellent discussion on the first question. Now, little bit on the second. I think the second question has already been discussed partly. I may again ask how to comment on a murmur. Radiation intensity, do they apply to neonate as we learned in adult cardiology?
I think I will just summarize that aspect, that particular question, and the question after that, NADAS criteria for functional murmur.
Yes, we'll take that question.
NADAS criteria, if you take, diastolic murmurs are classified as major murmurs, whereas systolic murmurs beyond grade 3/6 are dangerous murmurs. If you have a baby with cyanosis and no murmur, that is much more dangerous condition. Cyanosis, no murmur, it can be TGA, it can be pulmonary atresia of whatever the anatomical context, because your duct is very much small, the murmur from the PDA cannot be appreciated. So even if there is no murmur, the heart diseases are going to be critical in neonate. Now coming to the loud murmur. Loud murmurs in neonates are only two important causes. One is outflow tract obstruction. Either it can be left ventricular outflow tract obstruction like aortic stenosis or right ventricular outflow tract like critical pulmonary stenosis. Second is AV wall regurgitation, tricuspid regurgitation or mitral regurgitation. If you take all these things, the commonest cause for loud systolic murmur in a neonate is tricuspid regurgitation. Now, tricuspid regurgitation is common in variety of conditions, PPHN, HMD, MAS, whatever condition is there, first thing is going to be inserted is the right ventricle. So, TR is going to be very, very common in all these pulmonary hypertension groups. So, loud murmur, which is lower down, the left lower sternal border suggestive of that. Remember that small VSTs will not produce murmurs. Then outflow murmurs cannot be audible. Outflow murmurs means flow murmurs. Loudest murmur in a neonate, which is audible on the bony prominence and all those things are outflow tract obstruction. Otherwise, we can't give consideration to the soft systolic murmurs in a neonate.
Thank you, sir. Arvind Shanai, sir, anything on this?
Not really. I think Nageshwar Rao garu has covered it very nicely.
Okay, the next the point of discussion is interpretation of X-ray. That is oligemia, pulmonary plethora, pulmonary markings, and a very practical question, which like a little bit of discussion we can have here.
Sir, can I answer?
Yes, sir. Please.
Yeah. I am just wondering, I would actually like to see your X-ray. The X-ray which you have shown is oligemia, you said. Then you said it's a simple transposition of great vessel. I just want to tell you, it may be overexposed film. Simple transposition of great vessel by definition is TGA with a small AST and a small PDA. Will not have oligemia at all. They will have normal pulmonary vascularity. X-ray with normal pulmonary vascularity, detransposition of great vessel. X-ray with reduced pulmonary vascularity, pulmonary atresia group. So now how to differentiate that? If you take X-ray into lateral one-third, middle one-third, and medial one-third, if the vascularity is seen in the middle one-third, that is a normal. If vascularity is seen either in the medial one-third or not seen, that is oligemia. Whereas vascularity extending to the periphery, that is the lateral one-third, is called as a plethora. In neonate TGA, usually you will see a normal vascularity, but a severe cyanosis. And as you presented, that child is just quite comfortable, called as a peaceful cyanosis. It will be there for some time, peaceful cyanosis. But you are frustrated because saturations are pretty low, lesser than 70% or so. So you remember that basically oligemia, pulmonary atresia group, plethora, increased vascularity group like truncus arteriosus, TAPVR, or whatever the admixture lesion with no PS, and normal vascularity TGA with intact.
Great, sir. Ravin Shanai, sir, anything?
One point, we have been fooled many times by TAPVC, which we have mimics HMD on the X-ray. So that is one differential diagnosis. If you have a child with HMD, you've given surfactant, it's not improving, and you are having problems with severe high oxygen requirement, we don't really look for cyanosis. We are keep giving high oxygen. I think one of the points to keep in mind is you may be dealing with a TAPVC.
TAPVC? Yes, please, sir.
Not resolving HMD, differential diagnosis is TAPVC.
Actually, TAPVC is very interesting. It has been the dark horse all along. In the pre-echo era, when we were managing babies, we used to, you know, some of the TAPVCs used to be branded as PPHN and whatnot. So, like, this is one of the things that we all need to really take into, we need to be careful about. Another point which probably, you know, I can put forward is that the time of how many hours of birth or how many days of life is also important when you interpret X-ray, because the transition period, some extra pulmonary markings may not be of much importance. Once the transition, the adaptation has taken place, X-ray will evolve. So probably the day or hours of life also, when you say in exam, you need to say this X-ray is taken at so many hours of life. So probably if it is taken at birth and all, then you're saying very high vascular markings, and probably the interpretation has to be made accordingly. Dr. Dinesh Chirla, any comments before you go on to next? Yeah.
No.
Yeah. Please jump in whenever you have any comments.
No. I think it's going on well.
Okay. So now the next topic is, as per the questions, is pulse oximetry screening. So there are 2-3 questions on that. So before that, another philosophical question rather, in a fetus, so SpO2 of 60% is tolerated and growth is not hampered. In postnatal CCHD, why don't we accept SpO2 of more than 60%, and why do we target more than 80%?
I think it is very important thinking that fetal, as we all know, that oxygen dissociation curve of fetal hemoglobin. The fetal hemoglobin affinity of oxygen is very, very high, even at low partial PA pressures. So a low resistance placenta oxygenation takes place even with low PO2 levels, and it delivers at the tissue level. Actually, if you look at, you don't need a lot of PO2, lot of SpO2 when you have good fetal hemoglobin. Whereas postnatally, the pressures are higher. Even if you have some kind of fetal hemoglobin, they don't tolerate them. But some of the cases like a tetralogy of fallot and all, they have cyanosis up to 6 weeks to 3 months of age. Then they start developing spells and all, because fetal hemoglobin almost disappears by the end of 90 days or so. You are replaced with adult type of hemoglobin. So essentially what we want to tell is fetal hemoglobin has got a high affinity of oxygen, even with low partial pressure. So that's why they tolerate very well. It's a probably natural adaptation mechanism.
Thank you, sir. What about Arvind Shanai, sir?
Absolutely agree with you. The fetus is adapted to a hypoxic environment, but a neonate has to adapt to a normoxic environment. That's the difference.
And probably the placental life is such that everything is taken care by the placenta, the fetal life. So not much of work need to be done. You don't need to have so much of worrying, but once the baby comes out, everything is on the baby's heart. So probably that also partly plays a part. Now, another question on the pulse oximetry, the preductal SpO2, if suppose a hypothetical scenario, this is because of the confusion between the American, American and British recommendations and the conflicts and the discussions. What are the values and the ranges in pulse oximetry screening? So preductal SpO2 95, postrectal is 99. Do we still call it failed screening since the difference is more than 3?
I really don't know the current values of that. But whenever there is a difference of more than 5, we can definitely say that there is a gradient is there. The borderline conditions between 3 to 5, pulse oximetry, the presentation you have shown also, the waveform is not good. You should have a stable waveform at least for 30 seconds to 1 minute. Otherwise, the readings will not come. Second is when you are talking about the saturations lesser than 80%, lesser than 60%, pulse oximeter doesn't hold. It doesn't have specificity at all. You see this Chinese pulse oximetry, which is given to COVID patients, it doesn't sense lesser than 90% at all properly. Less than 80%, you can forget about it. So when you are talking about the gradients of pulse oximetry, if it is ABG, I will agree. Pulse oximeter, I think we should have 5% gradient minimum.
So probably the confusion is because the recent new reviews which he quoted said the difference of 2. Previously it was 3. So that is why the whole confusion. Arvind Shanai, sir, any final word on this?
Sir, I agree. I agree what you said.
So probably the answer to that question, we need an answer. He needs an answer, the person who is there. So predactal SpO2 95, postdactal is 99. The other way around. Or since the difference is more than 3, is it significant? So probably what he meant is pre-ductal 99 and post-ductal 95. Difference is 4. So is it significant?
Dr. Aisha, can I put it the other way?
Yeah.
Once your post-ductal saturation is more than 95, does it basically rule out any major cyanotic congenital heart disease or critical congenital heart disease?
I think that is probably an appropriate statement rather than thinking about a gradient.
So see, what happens is technically for a new screening UTM, it will always come.
Yeah.
2% or something if you go technical definition. But once someone says your postductal SATs are more than 95, we should start thinking about a critical congenital heart disease or pulmonary hypertension, which is what this has been designed to screen. And whoever has asked this question, I think that is probably what we should take a gist of this. Basically, this has been done to screen critical congenital heart disease. And once your postductal SAT is more than 95, I think you pretty much are saying that you are fine.
Yeah.
And moreover, the screening test is done on asymptomatic babies, yeah, not on the symptomatic baby. That's why probably the arterial gas is not done in such scenarios. So next, can we move to the next topic? That is prostaglandins, straight away. Sir, please tell us, in a baby with duct-dependent pulmonary circulation like tricuspid or pulmonary atresia, prostaglandin on PGE1, baby develops respiratory distress. How do we know it's because of heart failure or excess PGE1 and pneumonia?
I think he very well described that, presented that complications, adverse effects of the prostaglandin. The predominant adverse effect of prostaglandin in the beginning is dose-dependent apnea. So when you want to transfer a baby, don't immediately transfer after starting prostaglandin. Keep the baby for at least 4 to 6 hours in your area, because that is going to cause apnea, obviously. So, and once you give loading dose, a lot of people believe, 50% of people believe to give loading dose, but we don't believe in giving loading dose. You can straight away give a 50 nanogram per kg per minute. When baby arrives with a severe desaturation or acidosis, then gradually de-escalate the dose. Some people, they actually start with the low dose and then go high dose. Some people start with the high dose and then come to low dose. When you are transferring our peripheral people, when I'm teaching, starting high dose is not a good idea because they develop recurrent apneas and you need to end up with intubation. Now, keeping the baby on prostaglandin for beyond 72 hours, it will again cause a problem, like developing flooding of lungs. Duct will become very large. It will become dilated. It will cause compression on the left pulmonary artery. Then you will see third day, fourth day, your left lung is getting collapse, atelectasis and all. That is because of your PDA is opened very well. So when you are giving a prostaglandin, we should first understand whether it is a duct-dependent pulmonary circulation or duct-dependent systemic circulation. Duct-dependent pulmonary circulation, like all pulmonary atresia, the requirement of prostaglandin is very less because their PO2 levels are low. Catabolism of prostaglandin also low. Whereas duct-dependent systemic circulation like coartation, hypoplastic left heart syndrome, interruption, their PO2 levels are high. Whatever prostaglandin you give, catabolism is going to be high. It will not work. That's why you tend to give more prostaglandin in case of left-sided disease compared to the right-sided disease. So you should remember, if duct is shunting more, then we should think about reducing the dose or sending the baby for surgery immediately.
One additional question in this regard is, can we start ionotropes before PG infusion in cardiogenic shock when you're not sure of the diagnosis?
I think it is absolutely mandatory when you have a neonate with cyanosis, severe cyanosis, respiratory distress coming to you. You already diagnosed it is a pulmonary atresia. Three important things. Give good preload. Then increase SVR. Then third is prostaglandin. Suppose if you don't increase the SVR and hypovolemia baby, inotropes will not work on hypovolemic baby first. You should have U volume. Your volume should be very good if you want to really make your SVR should be high. Why SVR is high? SVR, if you have systemic vascular resistance high, it can shunt significantly through the PDA into the pulmonary artery. If you have hypertension, even you increase your PDA size, the amount of blood which is going to lungs is going to be less only. You are go on increasing the prostaglandin rather than maintaining your blood pressures and euvolemia properly. So it is very important and wonderful point that you discussed that SVR should be increased. Either you start to adrenaline or you start to dopamine. That is based on your experience and your institutional protocol.
Thank you, sir. Arvind Shanai, sir, anything regarding prostaglandin?
Absolutely. We follow two dictums. Number one, if we are thinking of prostaglandin, we invariably intubate. But that is in a tertiary center. I think it is sensible to intubate rather than wait for the apnea to come. And second thing is, in any sick neonate, I think the principles of hemodynamic measurement, which I believe was discussed the last time, apply. You first need to make sure euvolemia, then appropriate inotropes, and only then I think we think about prostaglandin. I agree totally with Professor Nageshwar Rao, sir.
Yeah, Manoj, can I ask a question to Francis? He's getting bored sitting listening.
Yes. Let's ask him.
Francis, if you have an antenatally diagnosed duct-dependent lesion, like suppose TG and other things, and is delivered in your unit, and would you set up immediately after birth, you get to the unit, and suppose it's a hypoplastic left heart and this child has been come to your unit, admitted, diagnosed. Would you start this babies immediately after birth on prostaglandin? Or would you wait for some time? How do you decide? Say it's a hypoplastic left heart, it's a coarct, it's a TJ, three different conditions. Which are the patients whom you would start immediately? Which are the patients you would wait? Which are the patients you would not start? And do you discuss with your cardiologist? Do you discuss with the cardiac surgeon? Do they have any concerns about prostaglandin before surgery?
Sir, I would coarctation of aorta. If it is critical coarctation of aorta, I would start.
Antenatally diagnosed, you attended the delivery, you got the baby to your unit. You have to give some instruction to your nurses. That's what I'm asking. It's a scenario. So it is a common nowadays, no? Very, very common nowadays. Very rarely sometimes, you know, with all this improvement in the fetal echocardiogram. And so Dr. Nageshwar has excellent fetal echocardiogram. He diagnosed most of the heart diseases. So we are not getting the chance to pick up cardiac diseases. So we know beforehand when they come to the unit. So what do you do? How do you decide when to start the prostaglandin, whether we wait? Because sometimes some of the surgeons have some concerns about prostaglandin. So I just wanted to highlight that. That's the reason why I wanted to ask you this question.
In a severe left obstructive heart lesion, I would start prostaglandin. As in, critical coarctation of iota with systemic hyperperfusion on clinically if you get clinically hyperperfused baby, perfusion is low with lower lip BP on the lower side, I would start prostaglandin infusion.
What about the pulmonary
also? Also I would like that dependent pulmonary circulation lesions also I start.
So Dr. Naisha, maybe, you know, I just wanted to highlight, see, from the cardiologist's point of view, like, do you want us to wait till you come and do an echo? Do you have a saturation at which you want to start us on prostaglandin? Are there some condition where you say don't start prostaglandin? Can you just sort of tell for all the delegates?
I think I like it, the question, actually. If you look at the presentation, the time of presentation of heart diseases, first heart diseases which are presenting are critical obstructive lesion, like a TAPVR which is obstructive. That is not the doctor dependent, so we will not discuss that. Critical aortic stenosis, critical coarctation of aorta and interruption, HLHS are the first one to present within few hours after. If you look at the world literature, the earliest cardiac surgery operation was done on HLHS with intact atrial septum. So what I want to tell is, when you have a left-sided obstructive diseases already which is labeled and very sure fetal, I think those babies, you don't want to demonstrate renal failure, going to low perfusion, cardiac dysfunction and all. Maybe if cardiologist is available, you can ask them to confirm the diagnosis, and probably saturation will not give information. I want to tell you that in left-sided obstructive disease, you don't go by saturation. It is the acidosis, renal failure, low perfusion. And I don't want to demonstrate those cases. It's better to start prostaglandin in all those cases. Whereas pulmonary atresia group, you can check the saturation. If the saturation is above 85%, you are reasonable and safe. If saturation is going lesser than 85% to 80%, probably you should not wait anymore and demonstrate. You can straight away start prostaglandin. That usually happens 48 to 72 hours of time. Whereas TGA now present setting, present method of treatment, if you are delivering in the tertiary care center where cardiology is also available, don't start prostaglandin, don't do septostomy, wait for 3 days. If there is anything in between, like low saturation, then you start. Otherwise, go for surgery. Whereas one tertiary neonatology center and cardiac surgeon is elsewhere, maybe your threshold is going to be somewhat different. You end up doing prostaglandin if the saturation is lesser than 85% or so.
Okay, so the answer is very complex. Dr. Vijayanand, you wanted to say something.
Sir, Nayakshara sir, just a little clarification or explanation. So what you said was the left-sided obstructive lesion is when that is critical. But what also we see in routine practice is there are the suspected or probable coarctations where they may evolve. In those situations, my understanding is that you would wait and monitor femoral pulses and lower limb blood pressures, and you can choose accordingly. If the things are showing that coarctation is evolving and the duct is closing, I just want your comment, sir.
Coarctation of aorta, by and large, cannot be diagnosed antenatally. That is the problem comes all over the world, because there are three theories are there. If there is ventricular septal defect, arch hypoplasia, coarctation is possible. If there is no ventricular septal defect, it is called as a duct cell migration theory. The PDA cells, smooth muscles, will migrate into the aorta, and then which will cause constriction of the circumferential diameter of the aorta along with the PDA. So a lot of times we diagnose coarctation during antenatal period, but there won't be any coarctation. It will be mild isthmal narrowing. Suppose you start prostaglandin thinking that they are coarctation, you are actually producing PDA, and later on you may have to ligate that PDA. So that is the reason why in coarctation, antenatal coarctation is always should be confirmed postnatally. But remaining heart diseases like critical aortic stenosis, interruption, hypoplastic left heart syndrome, there is no question about that. You have to start prostaglandin irrespective of the cardiologist is there or not. That is, so Dr. Manoj asked a very complex answer. I will just tell only one. Left-sided disorders, start prostaglandin. Right-sided disorders, check saturation. And third is TGA, based on the surgeon availability and your area of living, you start prostaglandin.
Excellent, sir. This is the message probably that should be carried around. And we work in resource-limited neonatology, some of the centers. So like we do not, all the centers do not have cardiac surgery facility. So that is again another point that needs to be considered. And if you need to if you are in a center, that is, that point is well explained. Very nice explanation by Dr. Nagesh Rao. If you have a center where cardiac surgeon is with you, then you will not start prostaglandin for TGA. But if you're in a center and then you're going to transport the baby, then probably your threshold for starting will be much, much lower. Now, a few more questions on this. Before that, Arvind Shanai, sir, anything on this?
Really?
Dr. Manoj, the prostaglandin, someone just asked this question.
There are 2-3 more questions, actually. Please go ahead.
Prostaglandin only. See, Dr. Nagesh and Dr. Arvind can probably, because there's a query about it. Is it elective intubation after prostaglandin based on, is it dose dependent? Or is it apnea dependent, or is it elective? That's one of the questions which has been raised.
And this is a question that is actually debated between the neonatologists and the pediatric cardiologists. There are a lot of opinions. Very nice scientific discussions take place when the question is asked. Please, forum is open. Please go ahead, both of you.
I think Dr. Arvind, sir, sir, would you like to comment, sir, again?
Already brought out the fact that we don't have in-house cardiac surgery. So when we have diagnosed a condition which requires prostaglandin, invariably this baby is going to require transport. So in our unit, we electively intubate, prepare for transport, and then send. Because there is no point, as you clearly said, waiting for apnea to occur, especially during transport. So I think that is the location-based indication for intubation whenever we start prostaglandin.
I agree with Dr. Manoj. There is a lot of debate is there whether to intubate or not. In our setting, like Andhra Pradesh and Telangana, we actually try to avoid intubation as much as possible.
Even when you are going to transport to a center and you don't have much control over the transport?
I will just tell you, sir. If it is a left-sided heart disease, they need to be intubated because of the acidosis. Your acidosis and heart failure will be well corrected under ventilation and prostaglandin and inotropes. We always, even when we receive the baby in our tertiary center, we have surgery and all. We electively intubate when baby is in shock, especially left-sided heart diseases. Right-sided heart diseases, pulmonary syntax septum, or VST, pulmonary atresia, whatever the anatomical context, you can wait and you can see. There's no emergency in intubation unless you are directly bringing the baby to either cath lab or into surgery. Anyway, you have to intubate for surgery and cath lab procedure. If you are waiting for some time, we are not intubating in case of drug-dependent pulmonary circulations.
I think
your question is, we are transferring from somewhere 250 kilometer or 150 kilometer. Right. I think that is important question. Maybe if you are feeling that the safety of ventilation is good, we should ventilate only. And most of the patients, they come on ventilation only. I also agree with that point.
If you can, if your transport system is well developed, then unless the baby has apnea, there is no need to intubate. But practically what happens is some of the time you are forced to intubate and send because of the...
Why I am telling that example, I will tell you. 4 years back, I have a patient from Bhuvaneshwar, Orissa. Indigo Airlines refused to take the baby. Then there is no alternative for them. They traveled in the railways with the prostaglandin infusion and the nurse without intubation. I am not telling that those are the examples. But if situation is not available, you don't have ventilation, you don't have incubator, then that is the scenario I am talking.
And a few more questions on prostaglandin. There are actually many. I'll try to add on. I mean, put them together. What is the lowest dose of prostaglandin that you recommend? And what are the complications of long-term prostate? That I think is partly answered. It is, somebody says that textbooks say osteopenia as a complication of long-term PG even.
So if you have a baby with a shock, I think you have to really start a very high dose, especially systemic circulation, interruption and coartation. And what we'll do is we'll de-escalate the dose. And most probably in left-sided disorders, you will end up stopping at 40 to 20 micrograms, 20 nanogram.
Nanograms.
Whereas in case of pulmonary arterioses, you don't need to start. You can even reduce to 10 to 20 nanogram. But we never go down to 20. 20 is our, we recommend 20. But in our unit, we even go to 10 units and then keep. But 20 nanograms is the lowest one, which I would prefer to tell everybody because your practices should be standardized across the state.
When do we stop?
That question.
When do we stop prostaglandin? Somebody has asked.
We don't stop prostaglandin if the baby is going to surgery. We stop prostaglandin if baby is going to cath lab, especially PDS stenting. If you are doing a PDS stenting, we stop prostaglandin 4 hours before the procedure because we don't want to have very much dilated ductus and we can't put a stent. Stent will migrate to pulmonary artery. So worldwide practice is to stop prostaglandin for 4 hours prior to the procedure in the cath lab. Whereas in surgery, don't stop at all.
Actually, can I just comment on the dose, sir?
Yeah.
Sir, I mean, one of the Nageshwar sir, you can correct me. My understanding is one of the thing is when we are starting prostaglandin, the key thing we need to say, are we trying to keep the duct open, which is already open? Or are we trying to open the duct, which is already closed? So a postnatally diagnosed duct-dependent condition, which came to the collapse state, as Nageshwar sir rightly said, you want to use the higher dose, more so for the left-sided lesion. But somebody like when we have a Nageshwar sir, like when we have a fetal diagnosis, and we know that it's a critical congenital heart disease, born in a center where the cardiac facilities are available, and where you know that the duct is immediately open after the birth, you want to maintain the patency. The usually my understanding in working the other cardiac units also, you start on the lower dose as low as 5 nanograms as well.
Absolutely. Sir. 5 nanograms, I'm not sure, but...
5 to 10, yeah.
So probably to take home message for to open a ductus, loading dose 50 to 75 nanograms or even higher, and to maintain 10 to 20 nanograms. Is that okay?
Okay.
Give a message?
Absolutely fine.
Fine. Now, there is two questions regarding the outcome. Actually, regarding, we'll take it and then we'll go back with a lot of questions. So, outcome, one question specifically to Dr. Rao, how is the long-term neurodermal outcome of patients with cyanotic heart disease post-surgery? And there is another question, HLHS, when we know the outcome is not there, is it okay to start prostaglandin? I don't think outcome is not there anymore because we have cases, of course, the outcome is very, very bad. So, please go on, sir. Outcome... Yeah.
I think it is a very lot of literature is available in this neurodevelopmental outcome in cyanotic congenital heart disease who underwent surgeries or native cases in the neonatal period. The interesting thing is, as you all know, that fetus saturation is low and PVO2s are low. Even postnatally, cyanosis is there, saturations are low. They really don't develop that cerebral ischemia and then problem. The all problems came after TGA operations and septostomy. Lot of papers on balloonatal septostomy, microemboli, shore of emboli will go to the brain and cause microinfarcts. Similarly, in neonatal surgeries with the earlier techniques where they used to cool the TCA called as total circulatory arrest, in that cerebral ischemia used to happen. There's a comparative study of MRIs and other parameters, which showed that there's a significant neurodevelopmental problems, especially in TGS, ductal-dependent circulation, and HLHS. Now, with the techniques, they evolved and changed cardiopulmonary bypass, selective cannulations, good cerebral perfusions. Now, neuro outcomes are very good in most of the cases, except in HLHS, where intrauterine hypoxemia causing the problem in that, which still people don't understand. There is a study from Canada where they have done the cerebral, fetal cerebral circulation. Actually, in HLHS, because of the obstruction of the aorta, you need to have retrograde circulation from the PDA to the ascending aorta. If the circulation is compromised, they universally will have a cerebral problem. So neuro outcome developments are somewhat guarded in some cases of HLHS. Remaining are all reasonably okay now.
Arvind Shanai, sir. We'll go on to the next talk. There are a lot of topics. So one question I missed. Yes, anything?
The saturations and...
Yes. We'll go back actually. X-ray. Let's go to X-ray. There are two, three questions. One is the ideal time for taking chest X-ray to rule out congenital heart disease, if at all it can be used. And in a rotated X-ray, can we comment on cardiomegaly or cardiac status, or is it useless X-ray from cardiac point of view? So role of X-ray, just to summarize.
So who is answering? You want me to take or Arvind, sir?
I would either of you, whoever is want to take it.
I really don't know the ideal time. Honestly speaking, I don't know the ideal time of chest X-ray, but I can comment on the cardiomegaly. In neonates, cardiomegaly is considered as more than 0.6%. You always will have pseudocardiomegaly because of, number one, you are taking in the AP film. Second is the phase of respiration you don't know. Most of the times it will be taken during expiration. And third, thymus shadow. All these things cumulatively will increase the cardiothoracic ratio in neonate. That's why it's difficult in a rotated film to comment on the cardiomegaly. But X-ray is very important to define the oligemia. Suppose you are in periphery, cyanosis is 80%. You want to know whether it is pulmonary atresia or TGA. Take X-ray. That will give very good information. But commenting on the cardiomegaly immediately, unless you have a gross right atrial enlargement, like Epstein's anomaly, wall-to-wall heart, subtle borderline cases is much more challenging.
Arvind Shanai, sir?
Yeah. The role of X-ray is when you don't have a pre-diagnosed cardiac lesion, have a sinus missing. It's very important, as I told you, is to differentiate pulmonary from cardiac. And that is where the role of the X-ray as a neonatologist comes in, where you are able to see if there is lung pathology, and definitely that will lead you on to looking at, except as I told you, where we have floundered, it's in TAPVC. Otherwise, very clearly to differentiate in your algorithmic approach to a sinus neonate, if the chest X-ray shows pulmonary pathology, that clearly helps you at least to rule out and concentrate more on the pulmonary rather than cardiac. But a normal appearing lung should alert you that maybe this is either non-pulmonary cause of respiratory distress or cyanosis.
And regarding the time, ideal timing, probably the physiological answer would be when the postnatal adaptation is over. So not before 12 hours or any other value you want to convey, sir?
Manoj, I don't think it's based on the clinical condition.
No, specifically for cardiac to comment on that.
That's what I say. If I have a very sick child, I might ask for X-ray very early.
Definitely, yes.
Distress, and I say, okay, fine, the SATs are there, let me sit on it and do X-ray a little later, saying that the TTN is not causing any, it's not interfering with my diagnosis. So that's when your postnatal adaptation comes. So there may not be any right timing answer for this type of question.
Yeah.
You have to take clinical context into and then take this thing.
Okay.
But Arvind, hyperoxia test, are you really doing it? And Francis spoke about hyperoxia test. You always still read in the book about hyperoxia test. I don't remember doing it for a long, long time.
I don't do it. I'm actually a protagonist against it because I feel giving 100% oxygen is toxic. And without a diagnosis, I don't think you should do it. But that may be because we have pediatric cardiology on site and we are more confident with our functional echoes. So difficult for me to answer what you want to do in a peripheral area.
But I think, yes, sir, please go ahead.
Oxygen is a toxin. We must be aware that oxygen is poisonous. And especially in preterm babies, you should be very careful before you do such a test.
100% agree with this. Eh? We should not do this test. This is actually described in all textbooks. So you must have mentioned for completion's sake, if you have facility for, if you can do a functional echo, you should never do this test. This is for centers which don't do properly.
I think it came like this. The hyperoxia test came in the early days where echo was not available. When child comes with the respiratory distress, physician failed to understand whether it is due to pulmonary pathology or cardiac pathology. You give 100% oxygen for 10 minutes and take the ABG before and after. Now, it is ridiculous to take ABG before and after and ridiculous to give oxygen 100% as Arvind sir is telling absolutely. What peripheral people can do is, if you don't have any facility, check the pulse oximeter before and give oxygen. If you are giving in a duct-dependent circulation, actually danger of closure of PDA is there. That is much more worse. Probably it may be useful in an infant with respiratory illness. You are confused to do that may be useful. And also it's important from the student point of view to know the answer from the exam point of view.
Maybe it should be deleted from the textbooks, sir. Now it is obsolete. We have better methods and have not seen in quite a few cardiac units working with. So I think it's potentially dangerous.
No, I don't think, not even non-cardiac units, we don't have a cardiac thoracic surgery, but nobody does. I don't think anybody does, but it's all mentioned in all textbooks and the questions are being asked in exam, unfortunately. That is why the whole thing you must have presented, probably
echo is more available than the arterial bed gas, even periphery nowadays.
Yeah. Okay, now another topic which probably Nijo also did not touch. Practical points on normal ECG and critical congenital heart disease. So critical congenital, you mean to say that you do not give that classification. You do not talk about the arrhythmias and that group actually. Probably that is what So any what all a neonatologist should know? Nageshwar Rao, sir.
I think couple of important points are still there in ECG. We cannot ignore ECG. ECG. Right ventricular hypertrophy is inevitable in all neonates within 72 hours, first 72 hours. So T wave in V1 lead will be upright in the first 3 days. Persistent of T wave in V1 beyond 72 hours or beyond 5 days of life, 100% suggestive of right ventricular hypertrophy. So when you are talking about right-sided heart diseases like pulmonary atresia, tetralogy of Fallot, or TGA, if the T wave is upright after 5 days, definitely 72 hours, but 100% after 5 days, it suggests that it is a right ventricular hypertrophy. Now you have a question. There is a PDA-dependent circulation, whether useful to me ECG or not. Yes, it is useful. In case of Epstein's anomaly, joint right atrial enlargement, RAV, will be there. And QRS complexes will be very subtle and right bundle will be there. Most of the duct-dependent pulmonary circulations are systemic, will have right-sided dominance, right ventricular dominance, except, I told you already, hypoplastic left heart syndrome, pulmonary atresia intact septum, that is. Second is single ventricle. Tricuspid atresia will have only left-sided forces. That means V5 and V6 will have tall R waves. Remaining all congenital heart diseases, you will have S waves. That is the only difference you will get Otherwise, by and large, ECG contribution in a neonatal heart disease is less compared to the XLV.
Alkappa is something bit of.
Alkappa generally, by and large, presentation during neonatal period is rare, but it is possible. I am sorry to tell that it is possible. If you see QFs in L1 and AVL and V5 and V6 ST elevation, that will give information regarding Alkappa. Usually we see beyond neonatal period, but as you said that it is possible in neonatal period, 25% of cases can present during neonatal period, and ECG will give definitive diagnosis. I'm sorry for missing that point.
See, Dr. Arvind, see, but one question by, which is very interesting. See, when we're talking managing HMDs and other things, we say we keep saturation 90 to 95. If you have someone in shock, we say 90 to 95. But when a critical congenital heart disease, we are saying, you know, they can tolerate lower SpO2. And they don't have neurodotal outcome. Why? Why it should be like that? You know, it's a question instead of, you know, why it changes? Why children with cyanotic congenital heart disease manage with lower saturations without any neurological outcome? Because
part of the question is related to the support trial, which actually looked at very, very small babies. And that is how we came upon this 90 to 95%. What we are talking about is here full-term babies who have congenital heart disease, where I think their amount of reserve, so to say, would be better. And as Professor Nageshwar Rao clearly said, here the adverse neurodevelopmental outcome is related to the cardiac procedures which are done in the babies and the techniques of surgery. And so it is totally different, these things. The 90 to 95 has come from support trial. And it talks specifically about very, very small babies, we must repair. And that has been extrapolated to everybody else. That is my thinking about it. And I think 90 to 95 is a good, safe window for almost all babies. But when you have cardiac lesions, you are dealing with a different physiology. And here all the points with which Dr. Nageshwar Rao has met, and I really learned a lot from his talk today, I think we should keep that in mind as neonatologists.
There is a question along with that. Why this 85% in pulmonary atresia? Any scientific basis? Why not 75 or 70?
Yeah, I will answer that. Dr. Vijayananda has got one question. He is
no, sir. I just want to comment after you, sir. After you, sir. We want to learn from you.
I just want to tell that if the saturations are above 85% in admixture lesion, the amount of pulmonary blood flow is more than 2:1. If the saturations are 80 to 85%, the amount of blood flow to the pulmonary circulation is anywhere between 1.5 to 2:1. If the saturation is lesser than 80%, the amount of pulmonary blood flow is less. Now, to summarize that what I told, when you have a pulmonary atresia, you should give good prostaglandin for the good PDA dilation, good pulmonary circulation, so that your saturation will be maintained. If the duct is small, saturation is going to be less than 80, you are not sure about when it is going to be closed or not. So that's why everybody is happy to keep 85%. If you have more than 85% of saturation, like in TAPVR and other things, your pulmonary damage is going to be much more high and they develop a pulmonary vascular disease very fast. That's why in truncus arteriosus, when baby comes with respiratory infection, we don't suggest that you maintain saturation of 92%, 95% and all, because your PVR drops abruptly. You are going to give more and more of blood to the lungs and their heart failure will never be controlled. That's why 80 to 85% saturation is very, very optimal in all cyanotic congenital heart diseases.
I think that's an excellent message, Dr. Naishra, because a lot of times, sometimes this child starts starting 90-95, and many of us feel happy and they try to continue the same infusion. It's important to give in the perception of the pulmonary blood flow about what it is. And just to sum it up, people who talked about this, why? I think my understanding, if you have shock along with hypoxia, you also, if you look at the cerebral autoregulation, blood flow and other things, that is where you have associated cerebral ischemia, which might set in. That's why the poor neurological outcome. When you have hypoxia along with shock, that's the reason why your SATs are, is probably one of the theory. So hypotension and low SATs are a bad combination. But if you have the other reason why the SATs, I think, have been nicely explained. Yeah, Vijay, you have to say something?
I think you essentially said, sir, a hypoxia with the relatively low saturation with the perfused argon is better and acceptable than a hypoxic argon with no perfusion, which is a bad situation. One of the other reasons why, that's my understanding, and others can comment or add, one of the reasons why you want 90 to 95% for a pulmonary cause is, if you start accepting the lower saturations, because in cyanotic congenital heart disease, the oxygenation is not an issue from the lungs. But if you start accepting the lower saturation, you might not be able to deal with the primary pulmonary pathology. You might be delaying too late. That's why 90 to 95. But congenital heart disease, because the perfusion is depending upon the perfusion, then you accept the lower. And also, we, as the doctors are excellently explained, think of pulmonary blood flow, because we often think more is good. Actually, sometimes is less is more. So we have to think about that percentages are beautifully explained. That's why you should not target higher saturations when there is a risk of increased pulmonary blood flow. I stop it there.
Excellent, excellent, Dr. Vijayan. That is nice. Now, most of the congenital heart disease have pulmonary arterial hypertension. So one question is, please explain the disadvantages of using pulmonary vasodilator like INO and sildenafil in these babies.
If there is a shunt lesion with the pulmonary hypertension, for an example, you have a TA-PVR without obstruction or truncus arteriosus without obstruction, the amount of blood flow is high. They will have high flow related pulmonary hypertension. It is meaningless to give either nitric oxide or sildenafil further reduction of PVR and produce more pain. Second is obstructive diseases producing post-capillary hypertension. Like for an example, you have severe LV dysfunction, whatever the mechanism, causing neonatal PVR not falling. It did not allow the neonatal PVR to fall to normal range. Or obstructive TA-PVR, pulmonary hypertension may be suprasystemic. Now, if you give nitric oxide or sildenafil, that can worsen the situation. Obstructive TA-PVR, nitric oxide is contraindicated. Sildenafil is contraindicated, because you are giving more blood to the obstruction area. So there is a danger of a situation in these scenarios, probably case to case basis. If the PPHN is the predominant component, probably we should consider nitric oxide or sildenafil.
Another related question is regarding furosemide. Does giving Lasix ease? Well, the question is probably what you meant is giving Lasix contraindicated since it can close the duct in babies with CCF requiring PGE1?
Can you tell the question, sir? I am not.
Okay. In a baby with CCF and requiring PGE1 for CCHD, does giving LAS, probably it is many, is giving LASIX contraindicated since it can close the.
No. If already you are on prostaglandin, if there is while waiting for procedure, either for surgery or for the cath procedure, if baby develops heart failure, you can give LASIX. But I would take that question in a different way. If we are putting a PDA stenting or BT shunt, if there is a heart failure because of the stable shunt excessive thing, we cannot give LASIX because hemoconcentration can cause occlusion of stent or occlusion of the BT shunt. In those individuals, actually beta blockers are indicated.
Add on, which are the drugs to be used and which are the drugs to be avoided in CCF in such babies?
So, BT shunt or PDA shunting causing heart failure, Lasix or furosemide, we can't give judiciously. We can actually reduce the SVR producing medications like any of the inotropes, adrenaline, dopamine, you should reduce it. Then you have to give beta blockers to reduce the SVR so that amount of magnitude of the shunt through the BT shunt or PDA shunt will come down, so heart failure will come down. If you give furosemide, hemo concentration can cause the occlusion of the procedure, whatever you have done. Whereas in case of prostaglandin causing a PDA, we can actually treat with furosemide. There is no problem because it will not get occluded with the hemo concentration. You are already giving prostaglandin.
Arvind Shanai, sir, anything? Yes.
We're reaching 9:15
now. We will wind up. I think we have covered most of the things. Some few, maybe a last question or last two questions, then we'll wind up.
I think one of the things which Sarnam is asking is, again, with the, I think someone is in periphery, you know how it takes some time to counsel the parents about shifting a child to for a cardiac and other things. How long it is safe to continue prostaglandin? That's what they mean, I think. You are in the periphery and you know how it takes time to counsel and they want to. So how long you can really continue on prostaglandin? 3 days, 4 days, 5 days, 1 week? How long you can continue?
I have seen prostaglandin giving 3 weeks. What will happen 3 weeks? As Sar mentioned, that osteoporosis is very common. But we generally keep prostaglandin 3 to 7 days. Is a reasonable time. You can give prostaglandin for 3 days in periphery. And beyond that, what will happen because of the infusion or prostaglandin itself can cause fever, vasodilatation, low platelet counts, leukocytosis, will confuse you the scenario of that baby is having sepsis. That's the reason we don't keep for long time on prostaglandin. Okay, let us go for vacation and come back and then do surgery and all.
Arvind Shanai, is there any comments? Okay, speaking of practice in periphery, there is one more question. Which are the cyanotic congenital heart disease in which the outcome is poor even after surgical treatment? When should we discourage parents to go for surgery?
I think at this point of time in our country, hypoplastic left heart syndrome is the only condition. I agree universally with everybody. My threshold towards counseling them is to discourage the treatment because you need to do 3 types of surgeries called Norwood stage 1, 2, 3. And long-term outcome in Boston series itself is not very great, 60% in 15 years of time. So pertaining to our country, it is an ethical question whether to offer a surgery or not. But my threshold, I will always imagine that baby is mine, what I will do. Same thing, I will apply principles that HLHS condition or any of the congenital heart disease with more than Down syndrome, like you have Edwards syndrome, Patau syndrome, I think we should seriously discuss with them because their mental retardation is going to be very, very serious.
All HLHS or some of the, because some of the variants of HLHS, their babies are quite okay. So do we straight away discourage surgery or?
No, variants of HLHS where the left ventricle is reasonable, we can go for single ventricle. They can live for 40-50 years. 40 years, so sometimes they can live. Whereas pure HLHS, aorta is 1-2 millimeter. Left ventricle is like a peanut. Those are the cases, I think, really. And already right ventricle is dilated, causing a tricuspid regurgitation. The outcomes are poor in those conditions.
Arvind Shanai, sir? I think we'll stop the questions unless anything more. Before that, any comments by Dr. Arvind Shanai?
I agree with you, sir. But we have the good fortune of having a cardiac center close by. So we always involve the cardiologist and the cardiac surgeon whenever we counsel. Which I think in these days, with Zoom available, I think you should make use of it. Rather than trying to take, because now nothing is in the periphery wherever Zoom is goes, it is
like this meeting.
One last thing is, before we start the OSCE by Dr. Vijayanand, is, see, we normally put them on iron supplementation, all children with congenital heart disease. What is the target hemoglobin? And especially with cyanotic angiotensin, anyhow, they become little plethoric, isn't it? So how do you diagnose polycythemia and then? I think good question. Do you still put them on iron supplementation?
Yeah, I missed that question. There are two questions related to that. Yeah. Similar.
Dr. Nayeshwara.
Can I answer? Yeah. I think a very pertinent question for this particular topic. Anemia, you diagnose based on the peripheral smear in cyanotic congenital heart disease. If it is microcytic hypochromic anemia and mean carboxylar hemoglobin concentration is less or MCV is less, then you are, and also you should do the ferritin levels, transferrin levels, iron levels, some centers, even recent one paper came actually, they are doing that. So these conditions, we should give, supplement the iron, because their HB may be good, but actually there is a microcytic hypochromic anemia. That is the reason we should supplement. And usually the crit is going to be around 40, hematocrit 45, which usually correlates around 14 grams. Whereas asymptomatic heart disease with the left to right shunts, this is also very important to give iron, especially in the 3 to 6 months age group where physiological anemia of infancy. The physiological anemia of infancy exaggerates the left to right shunt, and they will have heart failure, which is exaggerated in the presence of physiological anemia. So that's the reason, even in left to right shunts, during early infancy, we would prefer to start iron in those patients.
Thank you, sir. Dr. Manoj, you want to ask anything before we ask?
No, I think we are done. There are some topics like PDA we are not touched at all. There are some questions we have. I mean, probably this is on critical congenital heart disease, and we are not into controversies. PDA is a topic by itself.
PDA is purely a neonatologistic debate. The cardiologist role is very, very.
We will leave PDA totally out of today's discussion. So I think most of the questions have been covered. Still, if anybody has any queries, we can mail them also. We can try to get the answers.
With, someone is antenatally diagnosed congenital heart disease, and when to decide about CPAP and surfactant in delivery room, I would say based on the gestation, if you have antenatally diagnosed congenital heart disease, you have a preterm baby, especially extreme preterm, maybe you will have a threshold to sort of give them delivery room CPAP and surfactant if the distress is high, subcostal attractions. These are more clinically based decision, and the X-ray and other things would be helpful. But suppose if in the unit, in the this thing, child has a lot of subcostal attraction in drawing, then yes, you will have to differentiate whether you would like to give surfactant in the delivery room or take to the NICU, do an X-ray and then do it. This low SATs is because of lung or because of the heart. These are very decisions on site to be taken based on the situations which you are dealing with. But I think more preterm the baby, probably you will more err toward the side of the lung side. So I think
I would like to thank both the experts who have done a very wonderful job today, Nageshwar Rao sir and Arvind Shanai sir. It was really a very good learning experience for all of us having you for this. And I would like to thank my fellow Nijo also. You are very tense, I think. You are not presented. I made you present once, but you have done much better. You are just not talking here. Probably some mistakes also you committed. Probably anyway, it was good. Thank you, Nijo. And then, of course, the chairperson, Dr. Dinesh Shirla, is the heart and soul of Noel, for taking Noel to another level. Over to Dr. Dinesh.
Thank you, Dr. Manoj, for an excellent moderation and, for being always being supportive. I think before we conclude and have a sort of a take-home message from the experts and you, I'll ask Dr. Vijayanand, the consultant neonatologist at Remission's Hospital, to present the OSCE for today. I've shared the MCQs to all of the NNF fellows. So please answer the MCQs. Vijay, please, can you start?
Sure, sir. Sure. Thank you, sir. And It's been excellent discussion. And as Manoj sir and Dinesh sir said, we had excellent experts. I'm trying to do the slideshow. Yeah. So, I mean, our learners, of course, want to learn the subject, but they are also keen and interested for the assessment. So it's important to prepare for their exam as well. So a couple of simple ask is, which there are already a lot of discussion happened. The first one, so the question on the first ask is, name the type of heart disease aimed to detect by this screening test. Then, as per CDC guideline, as Manoj sir earlier mentioned, there are other guidelines as well. But as per CDC guidelines, what are the pass criteria for the test? And third question is, what is a positive screen? Or in other words, what is the failed test? I'm just checking the chat box whether I got any answers. Sir, am I supposed to see in the chat box or somewhere else, sir, for answers?
It depends. People answer anywhere. So.
Oh, they don't want to. They're all tired, I suppose.
I think it's a long discussion today, yeah.
What is happening?
Well, we already know, sir.
Yeah,
now, here is the answer. The first question, the critical congenital heart disease. If you say it is cyanotic, I'm afraid that's not the right answer. So it is a critical congenital heart disease, which is defined and agreed by major. Again, there's a controversy there. A congenital heart disease, which needs a intervention either per surgery or cardiac intervention within 1 year of life to decrease the mortality and morbidity. What is the pass test and what is the fail? Then I'll come to that. It is a CDC guideline. There's a discussion to change, but they haven't changed yet. So the pass test as per CDC, again, I say, is the 95 and above saturation is the right hand or foot, and three or less than three difference is the pass test between the right hand. You have to remember right hand and any of the foot is the pass pulse oximetry test. What is failed test? If any oxygen saturation is less than 90%, of any oxygen saturation less than 90% or foot on three consecutive measures or more than 3% difference on three consecutive occasions. So this is a failed test. I'm going to stop it there. And then the second question, you can see these heart disease diagrams, a line or schematic diagrams, as you want to say. The question is, what is the common among these four congenital heart diseases? Identify which one of them is different from other three, and in what way above congenital heart disease, which is a different, is from the other three. And Nijo beautifully discussed in his presentation, and Nayeshwar sir also beautifully explained on some of the discussions. I'm just trying to see, yeah, answer critical congenital heart disease, the right answer. I don't know whether that was the answer for the previous or this thing. I think in view of time, and I can understand you all tired, I'm going to the answers. And answer is a duct-dependent critical congenital heart disease. These are all. And the one which is different from the other three is the tetralogy of Fallot with pulmonary atresia. Why it is different from the other three? Other three are duct-dependent systemic circulations, and this one is a duct-dependent pulmonary circulation. I am going to stop it there, and over to you, sir.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Vijay, for the Soski. And I tell you, today's session was excellent, and there was a lot of learning for all of us also. And I take this opportunity to thank Dr. Nageshwar Rao, who shared his wisdom and knowledge about pediatric cardiology, and Dr. Arvind Shenoy, with all his experience, shared about a lot of take-home messages about managing such children. And Dr. Manoj for his excellent moderation. May I ask each one of them, Dr. Arvind, you want to give some take-home message to the student? One, Arvind, Manoj, and Dr. Nageshwar Rao, before we wind up.
My message would be, the commonest cause is respiratory. So when you evaluate a sinus baby, remember that and proceed to treat respiratory. Keep cardiac at the back of your mind. If you exclude a respiratory cause and you're thinking of non-pulmonary cause, probably cardiac come high on the list. Thank you. Over to Nageshwar Rao, sir.
It's a really wonderful session, and I really thoroughly enjoyed the presentation and the questions and answers from everybody is really very great. From the student point of view, when you have a neonate, you sit for 2-3 minutes, take points. What is the saturation? What is the PO2? What is the plethysmography? What is the X-ray? What is the clinical examination? Then analyze that. Then most of the times you will get. I would like to tell only one comment. I had a patient some 10 years back. The postgraduate diagnosed the case from one of the center. He said that I have umbilical venous saturation, which is 92%. Umbilical arterial saturation, which is 90%. Then some one more saturation, I don't remember. All equalization of saturations are there. I am thinking it's a TAPVR. Actually, that case was, I keep on telling that it was TAPVR. See, so what I mean to say is calcium levels sometimes will be low. Then you have a circulatory failure and acidosis. Think about a Dysgeusy syndrome arch interruption. So thank you very much, sir.
Yeah, Dr. Manoj,
you're
I would actually, you know, I mean, like, the topic anyway, it's a great discussion. I don't want to, we would actually like to hear from the fellows their critical views on the how the NOIL is taking place. Like anything, what are they gaining anything? And then any comments on how we can modify it further? Critical comments, please feel free. I just request to all the fellows, please feel free to give your inputs regarding what can be made better and all that. And regarding the OSCE, how to make everybody participate, I don't know. We need to think of something, probably will.
Thank you. And thank you, Francis, for an excellent presentation. And next week, there's one, this thing. We are having a guest lecture for a change in NOIL. And functional echo, point of care ultrasound has become a necessity for all neonatologists. And this is something which I thought if we can hear directly from the expert would be better. So we have arranged a special session next week. We have two prominent experts in the country who have taken a lot of courses who are going to take guest lectures next week. We have Dr. Pradeep Suryavanshi and Dr. Mohit Sahani who are going to take a session on functional echocardiography and on echocardiogram and on point of care ultrasound. So next week, let us meet up again for the NOIL session on these two topics. I'll be sending all the information. Please sort of complete the MCQs. And I will shortly share you a email address on which I think you can give the feedback, which Manoj has suggested. Earlier, I had sent in asking them about the timings and other thing, feedback things. I think on a similar platform, we'll share again from you to see what you guys would like. But thank you again. Thank you, Dr. Arvind, and thank you, Dr. Nagesh Rao, for your excellent sessions. I think it was really useful. And thank you, Manoj and Dr. Vijay Anand and all the faculties who have attended. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Good night.
Thank you.